Ready? Okay, so we're going to talk about more cache coherence today and hopefully finish a lot of what we have in multiprocessors. Before that, hopefully you guys are progressing on your assignments, right? You have a lab due next week. I don't want to remind you again, but I just did. Should be fun. And what we're going to cover today, you're going to do it in your lab 8. But just as a reminder, if you're interested in 740, and several of you have talked with me about 740, actually, it will be offered. Don't panic yet. It will be on the course schedule. And these will be the very, very, very likely times, even though it says tentative here. It's going to be that way. And we covered this, so you can go back and watch the lecture last time. And if you want to talk with me about it, feel free to stop by during my office hours. This is where we are in the lecture schedule. Just a little bit overview. We're going to finish coherence today. And we may actually start asymmetry a little bit, because I think there's a good tie-in to asymmetry. And then we have basically interconnection networks and multicore issues left. We'll talk especially about heterogeneous multicore, which is asymmetric multicore. But next week, early next week, I'm out of town. But we'll have two lectures, two guest lectures, which will be part of the lecture schedule. So which could be part of the exam. One is, actually both are really exciting topics. One is on DRAM, so you'll go into more detail. They'll be delivered by my PhD students who are defending very soon. Vivek will deliver the first one. He's working on in-memory computation, so you'll see where current DRAMs are headed. He'll talk about some basics as well as he'll give some cool ideas that can accelerate page copying by more than 10x. Basic orders of magnitude, think that way. Can you do operations in DRAM such that you can get acceleration that's an order of magnitude that faster than today's systems? And he'll talk about some cool operations. And you'll figure out that actually it's not that hard to do it. If you put a little bit more intelligence into DRAM, you can achieve things in a much better way. Well, why it's not done? Well, maybe it will be done in 5 years. So you can feel free to ask questions to Vivek. The next lecture on Wednesday will be delivered by Lavanya, who's defending at the end of this month her PhD thesis. And she'll basically talk about what she did in her PhD thesis, how to provide basics for predictable performance. Remember, we saw a lot of memory schedulers and actually approaches. Hopefully you remember this because you'll have your exam at some point. Memory schedulers that provide quality of service, fairness, and performance at the same time when you have memory interference across different cores. Right? You remember all those schedulers? Parallelism over batch scheduling. And we also saw other techniques like source throttling, mapping the data to different channels such that you reduce interference, all of these interference reduction techniques. Can we actually take some of these techniques and provide a substrate such that you can guarantee slowdowns for different applications? You're running 5 different applications together. Can you say, I don't want this application to be slowed down by more than 2x, let's say? Can you actually somehow design a substrate that can achieve this? So she'll talk about some preliminaries and basics of how you can achieve these. And this could be useful for you in the future. And this is an important problem because nobody wants stuff to slow down here, right? You want some applications to get guaranteed service. So that's kind of the outline for early next week. And then we'll get back to more multi-core issues and interconnection networks. And we're almost done, actually. You guys have been a really good bunch. So hopefully you'll keep doing that. If you want more lectures, we can do it. Some of you wanted more lectures, but we'll see. OK, let's talk about cache coherence. Remember, we left off at directory-based cache coherence. I'll skip these readings, but hopefully you guys are doing the readings. We were covering two cache coherence methods. We briefly talked about Snoopy bus. We're going to get back to it. Basically, this is bus-based. You have a single point of serialization for all memory requests. And every processor sees every other processor's memory requests, actions. And as a result, caches snoop these requests and decide what to do with the block that is cached. Right? And we'll get back to that. And we saw a very simple protocol, valid-invalid protocol. Right? You had two states. And whenever a processor wanted to write to a location, it broadcast on the bus a read-exclusive signal saying that I want to read this block exclusively because I'm going to do something to it later, that maybe write to it later. And everybody else that saw that request actually invalidated that block in their caches if they cached it. Right? That's a very simple Snoopy protocol. Now, we also talked about directory, Basically, it's a very different protocol. It doesn't require the central bus point of serialization for everything, but it needs a single point of serialization on a per block basis. And this single point of serialization could be distributed among nodes. So you may have 1,000 processors, and each of them may be actually having 1,000th of the memory space, and it could be serving as a directory for that. Right? So this is more scalable, as you can see. It doesn't require this bus. Having a bus for 1,000 processors, a shared bus, may be difficult. And we'll get to that when we cover interconnects, actually. So the upside of the directory is you can actually make explicit requests for blocks, right? Directory is the middleman, if you remember. I said that in the last lecture. It's a middleman. Everybody asks the directory first, and then the directory gathers the block and sends it to everybody and ensures that the block is kept coherent, right? Which is a really nice idea, actually. And you can see that this is developed earlier than the Snoopy bus protocols. Okay, so these are the methods. On top of this, you can have protocols, like what blocks can have in what states, right? We remember that the valid-invalid protocol actually can be implemented through a directory also, right? Basically, valid-invalid protocol that we saw before says that if you're going to write to a block, you should have the only copy, right? You can actually implement that through a directory as well. And we actually implemented it in the example that I showed you in the previous lecture. So think of these as methods of implementing coherence. But on top of this, you have different protocols like valid, invalid, and what we will see today, MSI, modified, shared, invalid. And we'll talk about modified, exclusive, shared, invalid, MESI. You may have heard of that. And we'll build up to these protocols. But they could be implemented using the two different cache coherence methods. So this will become more clear. Let's cover directory-based cache coherence really quickly. Everybody remembers this from last lecture? OK, I'll go through this really quickly, unless you scream for some reason. Hopefully, the reason would be this, not something painful. I guess this could be painful too, but hopefully not. So basically, we have a logically central directory that keeps track of where copies of each block resides, and caches consult this directory, right? And I'm going to go through this really quickly. Basically, let's get back to the example. This is one implementation of a directory. There may be many implementations, and we'll talk about it. We'll revisit it toward the end of, or toward the middle of this lecture. Basically, you have one bit. This is on a per block basis. For each block in memory, you have an entry that looks like this, and one bit per processor in the system, right? Indicating whether or not that processor has cached the block, right? And there's also an exclusive bit saying whether or not that processor cached the block exclusively. And we saw the importance of this, right? If this exclusive bit is set, first of all, for this to make sense, there should be only one processor's bit set if this exclusive bit is set. Actually, there should be exactly one bit set over here in terms of processors, right? There's no reason to have one over here and zeros all over here, right? That means the block is in memory. So exclusive means basically one processor, exactly one processor has cached the block and has exclusive access to it, meaning that that processor knows it can update the block without telling anything to anyone in the world. That's very powerful because now you can actually cache the block and keep updating it without notifying anyone, right? Even if it's a shared block, even if somebody else is going to modify it later, right? Make sense? That's the beauty of exclusive protocol. And we will see that in the MESI cache coherence also. Wait, why do we have, was it like that from the beginning? Or? Oh, OK. Never mind. Now I'm confused because that looks like this, and I thought you were not seeing the slides. OK, make sense? So there are many design choices actually here because you don't, the method is really flexible, right? And you mentioned some of these design choices. For example, we don't need to start with this state. Let's assume that the block is in this state, which means that processor 3 has the block as exclusive. At this point, let's say this is the state of the block, and P2, processor 2, takes a read miss. Basically, it wants to read the block. First of all, it checks its cache. It doesn't have it, right? And then basically, it sends a message to the directory saying, I want to read this block, block A. And directory checks the status of the block. It says, oh, I don't have the block. Somebody has the exclusive, and that somebody is processor 3. Now, directory can take the protocol that you design can be flexible, right? One protocol could be for the directory to tell processor 3, processor 3, give me back the block, right? And processor 3, directory can wait for that to happen. And when that happens, it now has the block. But the directory can also tell processor 3, processor 3, you can keep the block as well, right? Because somebody wants to read it. They're not going to write to it. So at this point, processor 3 still stays as having the block. And after the directory gets the block, it needs to send the block to processor 2, who requested it. So it sends the block to processor 2 and sets the bit for processor 2. So that's one way of doing it. And one of you mentioned that, oh, if processor 3 actually has the block, why doesn't that processor directly give the block to processor 2? You could do that also, right? The directory could have said, processor 3, you have the block. While you're giving it to me, also send it to processor 2. Make sense? So you could have done that too. So this kind of protocol enables this is called a cache-to-cache transfer. Right? You can actually do a cache-to-cache transfer with directory protocols also. You could do it with the bus-based protocol also, the Snoopy protocol. So why would that be useful? Because you don't get the block and then supply it to processor 2, because that may take a long time, right? You're going through the middleman. Whereas if processor 3 and processor 2 are actually really close, well, maybe it's faster for processor 2 to get the block, right? That's the idea over here. And we can actually illustrate it with, remember, the goal is to design a scalable system. Rotate twice. So you can have, this could be processor 2, this could be processor 3, and they could be really close to each other. And processor 3 has the block, and maybe they have some connection over here. Imagine some kind of network over here, and the directory may be really far, right, for some reason. Okay. Processor 3 sends a message, and then the directory says processor 3 actually, processor 2 requests the block. Directory knows that processor 3 has it, and asks processor 3 to send the block both to the directory as well as to processor 2. So the block can be supplied to processor 2 really quickly. That's the idea over here. And if the latency between processor 3 and processor 2 is much shorter than the latency between processor 3 to directory, this is a win. That's why a cache-to-cache transfer may make a lot of sense, right? OK. Any questions? Yes. Oh, that's a great question, actually. It doesn't need to. Again, it depends on your protocol. It depends on your protocol. Here, I was assuming that if the block is shared, that also means that the copy in memory is clean, meaning all caches plus memory have a consistent view of the block. But you don't have to have that. And we can also say, add more complexity and say, oh, block is shared, but memory also doesn't have the correct copy, which means that you need something else to indicate that, right? That was the assumption in the protocol. But you can actually design a protocol. We will see that, actually, in a little bit. OK? That's a very good question, though. OK, let's talk about Snoopy cache coherence, which is actually simpler. Right? We've discussed this before. In this case, all caches snoop all other caches. Yes, you have a question on the directory? Yeah.
Multiple caches have a view, and you're saying memory is clean that way.
That's right.
If one more cache requests it, can it also be possible that the latency, then can you still give it from one cache to another rather than supplying it from memory?
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. I mean, as long as you have that ability to send from one cache to another, you can do that. Right. But the reason I was assuming, actually, that's a good point, basically. The reason I was assuming that memory has the correct copy is when directory receives a request, it can directly supply it. Right? If that was not the case, if these were actually modified, the directory actually needs to ask again and get it. Right?
But it would still have to get it from memory, which might be a longer latency.
That depends, right? That depends. That depends on how big your system is, right, in the end. Remember, think about, let's say, thousands of nodes. It's a huge shared memory multiprocessor. P People tried to build these, and they built these, actually. Think about it as a data center with all shared memory. Right? One processor can access any memory in the data center, and they all share the memory. Yes?
If it's that big, then you have to consider failures.
Failures, you need to consider failures whenever you're designing a system, absolutely. Yeah, that's right. Too bad. I mean, that's an orthogonal issue. But yes, you need to consider that. I mean, you need to consider that even in existing processors, right? What if a bit in the register file goes wrong? So that's a similar issue. That's why it's orthogonal. But I think there is one point here. You actually need acknowledgments here in the directory, right? Because you don't know, especially if you're building a system like this, you don't know whether or not the processor that you're sending a message to receive the message, right? Whereas in a bus-based protocol, it's simpler because you have this shared bus, and as long as the bus is working correctly, hopefully when you broadcast something, everybody sees it, right? So in that sense, the direct, this kind of scalable system that we have over here, you need to consider, you need to build in to the protocol some acknowledgments. When you send an invalidate request, you want an acknowledgment, right? And this also ensures that the race conditions are gone, right? With the bus, there's a single point of serialization. So you still have race conditions, but your race conditions are less, or less easier to handle, if you will. Whereas with a directory, now you send a message to someone. By the time your invalidation is received by that someone, maybe they modified their block, right? So you need to ensure that you get the latest copy. Okay. Yes?
So if one of the caches, they have the exclusive copy, if every time the second cache wants to, you know, read data from it, does it have to, like, take back the block, or how does it work?
Exactly, yes. Exactly. If someone has the exclusive copy, you need to get that block from them if you want to do something to it.
Every time you want to read, you have to get the block, right?
Absolutely, yes. Absolutely. That's the price of coherence, right? You need to keep it coherent. Okay, let's look at the Snoopy protocols, a little bit, Snoopy methods. Well, I've just said that, right? All caches snoop all other caches, read-write requests to keep the block coherent. Which means that in each cache, you need to have some coherence metadata. Metadata meaning, what is the state of this block in terms of coherence, right? Remember, this metadata in the directory is this one. This is really your metadata per block. And you can imagine how big it is, right? We're going to get back to it again. You need to have a directory entry like this for each block. That's a lot of state, actually, in hardware. Imagine a 1,000-node system, 2 to the 10, 10 bits per block. If your memory is 1 terabyte, that's a lot of bits. Right. Yes?
Well, can you just do it per block in the cache rather than per block in the entire memory system?
That's right. You can potentially change this data structure instead of having one bit per block, you can actually have maybe kind of like a linked list or something that says, these are the processors that have the block, right? And these are their permissions. But then it's still a data structure. You still need to handle the worst case somehow.
Well, the worst case is the total number of blocks in the cache is not in memory.
Maybe you can design a different data structure, but your indexing may be more difficult, right? That's if your indexing is more difficult, then you have a slower directory. Yeah, you can absolutely optimize it. Okay, so going back to Snoopy cache coherence, basically we want this coherence metadata, but now it needs to be in the cache, right? You really have it in the cache. And this is easy to implement if all caches share a common bus, right? Each cache basically broadcasts its read-write operations on the bus. And this is good for small-scale multiprocessors, which means that if you have few processors doing this. When you increase the number of processors, let's say you want to have a 1,000-node multiprocessor, having a shared bus becomes difficult. And there are several reasons for it. One is you have a lot of electrical loading on the bus, right? It becomes really slow, if you can operate it at all. Also, your bandwidth reduces as a result, right? Basically, you're broadcasting to everyone. Everyone needs to see it. So you cannot communicate while one processor is broadcasting. So we'll see that when we talk about interconnects. But this is basically the view of the Snoopy cache. You have processors, you have caches, and there are some coherent state bits in the tag store over here. We'll see some protocols like MESI, and you have a shared bus. And there are processor actions. We saw this before. Processor can do processor read and processor write to a block, and these get translated to bus read and bus write, or bus read exclusive, coming from the cache. And everybody sees these bus read and bus read exclusive signals. And we've seen this protocol, right? This was the simple valid invalid protocol that we had over here. And basically, it was a write through cache, write no allocate cache. That's why we kept it simple, actually. That's why you didn't have a modified state over here, right? If your caches are write through, you don't need to have a dirty bit. We've seen this before. So let's start extending this protocol, because maybe we want write back caches, right? How do you actually handle coherence in a write back cache? Well, obviously, you want a modified state if you have a write-back cache. So the next protocol is MSI, which is you have three states per each cache block. One is modified. It says cache line is the only cached copy and it's dirty. Shared says cache line is potentially one of several cached copies. And invalid is cache line is not present, right? So if you get a read miss, basically what happens is you send a read request on the bus, and the block transitions to shared state. Does that make sense? Let's take a look over here. No. Write display. Basically, when there is a read miss, you say, I want to read this block and broadcast. And somebody supplies a block. Let's assume that you get it. And you get it in shared state. You mark it as shared. Write miss, you send a read exclusive request, and the block goes into modified state, right? Okay? Basically, if you get a miss on a block, let's say you want to write to it, you send a read exclusive request, let's say to block B, and you get the block in modified state. And modified means it's an exclusive copy. That's the only copy that's up to date in the system, right? And when a processor snoops a read exclusive request from another writer, it must invalidate its own copy. This makes sense, right? Basically, if someone sends this read exclusive request, if anybody sees that there's a read exclusive request to block B, they basically invalidate their copy, okay? If there's any. And now you can have shared to modified upgrade, and you can make this upgrade without rereading data from memory. So if you have a block in shared state, let's say this processor has the block. Let's say that's block A. Block A. And this block wants to read exclusive A because it wants to write to it. It's in shared state. Shared state means it's clean, right? And this processor has it. So it broadcasts read exclusive A. And this cache says, oh, I have the block. And it supplies the block to this other cache, right? And it invalidates its own copy because you saw a read exclusive request. You supply the block, so the block goes here, it goes into modified state, and you have A, and this processor invalidates its copy such that it doesn't have it anymore. Make sense? It's pretty simple, actually. So you don't need to go to memory, which is nice. And this is the state diagram. I'm not going to walk you through this. We're going to talk about MESI, which is a more sophisticated one, and you're going to implement that. But yeah. For example, let's take a look at this one. Now, what I want to do is shared to modified. Yes, basically, if you are in shared state, and if you want to write to a block, you send a read exclusive signal such that everybody else will invalidate the copy, and you go to the modified state, right? Because you have the data. You have a copy that's up to date. You want to write to it, you can write to it. Does that make sense? But you need to invalidate everyone else. Okay? And you can do the other transitions yourself. It's clear, right? Okay. So what's the problem with this? Well, I guess I show you the problem over here. So there is one problem with it, and that happens if the especially if you don't have a lot of sharing of the blocks, right? If you this exact transition that I showed you over here, whenever you read a block, when you're in invalid state, when you do a processor read, you go into the shared state, right? Shared means I have the up-to-date copy, but somebody else in the system may also have it in the cache, right? Which means that you cannot, when you want to write to it, you cannot just write to it without informing anyone, right? You need to first invalidate everybody else because you're not sure at this point that no one else has a copy in their caches, right? So basically, when you get the cache block, you'd immediately transition into the shared state where you're not sure whether you're the only one or somebody else also has the copy, right? And that's the problem with this protocol. Basically, on a read, the block immediately goes to the shared state, even though it may be the only cached copy in the system. You may be the only processor who has that block at that time, right? Now, what's the problem with this? Basically, suppose the cache that read the block wants to write to it at some point. It still has the block, it has the only copy, but it doesn't know that it has the only copy. It still needs to broadcast and invalidate to everybody else. Right? Now that's a useless invalidate because that's the only copy, but the cache doesn't know that it has the only copy. Basically, if the cache knew it had the only cached copy in the system, it could have written to the block without notifying any other cache. Right? It could have saved that invalidation. This is very similar to the exclusive bit that we talked about in the directory, right? This is the power of the exclusive bit. The cache had a bit saying, oh, I have this block exclusive over there in the directory. As a result, the cache was able to write to that block without telling anyone anything. So we're going to do the same thing over here. Basically, the problem is this transfer from I to S. You go immediately to the shared state, even though you may have the only copy. So the MESI protocol extends this by adding another state indicating that this is the only cached copy and it's clean. Right. Make sense? This is called the exclusive state. I have the only cached copy and it's clean. And when you're reading, you place the block into the exclusive state if no other cache has it. Let me show you this one. I'll show you the state machine, so don't get scared, because you're going to implement, actually. But basically, we are adding this new state, which is the exclusive clean state. And instead of going from invalid to shared, we're going to go from invalid to exclusive clean if this is the only processor that has the block, right? And you can actually determine that, right? You can actually determine that when you're doing the read. So basically, you do a processor read over here, which gets translated to bus read. You broadcast a bus read over here. And while you're doing this bus read, all of the other caches can check, well, they need to check, actually, if they have the block. And if none of them has it, then you know that you have the only copy. Right? That's basically a wired OR signal. You basically OR the hit signals from all of the caches. If it evaluates to zero, that means you have the only copy, right? Make sense? And memory will, of course, supply the data in that case because no other cache has the copy. And you'll have the block, and you'll put it in the exclusive state. And that's the idea over here, which is pretty simple, actually, right? OK? So now what this enables is when you're in the exclusive state, if you want to write, you just write. If you get a processor write into the cache, you don't need to send anything to anyone. Basically, this is the signal that the cache sees, and this is the signal that goes on the Snoopy bus. So you don't need to send an invalidate. You can directly transition to the modified state. And the meaning of modified state is you have the only copy, only up-to-date copy in the system, and it's modified. It's dirty. So now we have four states: modified, exclusive, shared, invalid. And these are clean, and this is dirty. Make sense? Well, I guess we should cover one more thing. Basically, if you don't have the block, and if you're doing a processor read, you go to the shared clean state. When you broadcast the bus read, if any other cache has it, right? If any other cache has it, you go from invalid to shared state. If no other cache has it, you go from invalid to exclusive state. That makes sense because that's the real meaning of shared, right? Some other, now the shared state gives you a stronger guarantee, if you will. Well, the shared state still doesn't mean that no other processor has it, right? Because at this point, when you have the block, maybe two processors have it, but then one processor may invalidate the block. You may still have the only copy, but you don't know about it, right? You may get into that situation later. We can actually fix that also, right, with the wired OR signal. Anyway, I'll let you think about it. Does this make sense? OK, good. So this is also called the Illinois protocol because it was developed at the University of Illinois. And that's your paper, actually, Janak Patel, who is a senior professor over there right now. He developed it with one of his students. And it's a beautiful paper if you read the first half. How many of you have read the first half? No one yet. Don't read the evaluation. That's not that interesting. But read the first part. It's written beautifully at that time. I'm going to turn down some of these shades. Let's do this sheer. Okay. This is basically the figure I've shown you over here. And you can go with this. Now we have four states. Modified means exclusive copy modified. Exclusive means exclusive copy clean. Shared copy clean. Invalid, clearly invalid. Right. And these are the actions that we've seen before, actually. And you can go through the state diagram. I think we've kind of went through it this way. So this is the important part that MESI protocol adds. That silent, basically going into this exclusive state enables a silent transition from exclusive to modified. And this saves a lot of bandwidth, actually, because you don't need to broadcast all of those invalidations. Okay. And this is another view of the state machine. And this is what you're going to implement. That's the fun part. It's exactly the same, actually, not much difference. So if you have a transition from a single owner, you can think of these as owner states, although I don't like necessarily the notion of owner here. But basically, you have a single owner means you can actually write to the data, right? Exclusive or modified. And if you transition from either exclusive or modified to shared, this is also called a downgrade in protocols. Right? You have this exclusive privilege. If you're in exclusive state or modified state, you can keep writing to it without informing anyone. Right? But if you actually go to shared state, you're really downgrading your privilege. Right? Because now you cannot write to it. You need to get access to it. There's also upgrade, basically, going from shared to exclusive or modified. That's called an upgrade, because that transition grants the ability to the cache which contains the respective block to write to the block. So it's basically some terminology. But this is essentially what you're going to implement in your lab. So hopefully you're ready for it. You get to know the guts of this protocol. And why is this important? Well, that's one reason, right? Somebody else implemented it for way before you did. Intel Pentium Pro, that's the first out-of-order processor, right? Well, first successful out-of-order processor, let's say. When we had the out-of-order processor, like I told you about the Motorola 88000, for example, right? They actually had an out-of-order machine that wasn't commercially successful. Actually, that wasn't internally successful either, but that's a story for later, perhaps. Perhaps with some beers. Yeah. Basically, this is what the Pentium Pro implemented. It's very similar. If you look at this, you get a processor read, and if you actually if some cache has it clean, you go to shared clean state. Or if some cache has it dirty, you go to the state, right? OK? Any questions on the MESI? You know the motivation for it right now, right? And most processors, most cache coherent processors out there implement a version of MESI, and actually a version of MOASI, as we will see. So let's take a look at some trade-offs. Again, you're the architect. You're designing these protocols, right? And you're actually questioning, why are you making some of these choices? You can actually change those choices, right? For example, should a downgrade from modified go to shared state or invalid state? Basically, you have the block modified, and somebody wants it, right? Somebody sent out a read request or a read, well, read request, let's say. Because if it's read exclusive, you'd better give it to get rid of that block, right? You don't want it to go to shared state. Somebody sent out a read request. What do you do with it? Do you supply the data and go to shared state, or do you supply data and invalidate what you have? Well, I guess I'm giving you the answer again. I shouldn't do that. Basically, maybe, again, this depends on whether you're going to reuse the data, right? If you're going to reuse the data before someone else writes to it, maybe you go to the shared state. But if you're not going to reuse the data, why keep it, right? Because at this time, you're actually updating your tag store anyway, maybe invalidate it at that point. So this all depends on the sharing pattern and update pattern again. And different processors make different choices for this. You can actually predict, right? Prediction is a really good tool for the architect. So you can come up with a prediction mechanism that does this well. Cache-to-cache transfer. On a bus read, should data come from another cache or memory? Again, we've discussed this, so I'm not going to go through this. You have similar trade-offs to what we've discussed earlier. If the cache are, well, I guess, yeah, I will very briefly go. Getting it from another cache may be faster, especially if memory is slow or highly contended, right? Getting from memory may be simpler, right? You don't need to wait. You don't need to have this extra path. That extra path actually adds complexity also, right? How do you get it from another cache? Think about it. You need to have a path to provide the data between the caches. Whereas that path already exists for memory. You're not adding anything new, right? And also, getting from memory enables less contention at the other caches. But getting from memory requires write back on M downgrade. This kind of sounds weird, but this is exactly the answer to the question that you asked earlier. Basically, in the directory, you have the same thing. Why? Basically, if you want to get it from memory, memory should have the up-to-date copy, right? Which means that when you're downgrading on a modified, which basically you have a modified state, you have the block in the modified state, and somebody wants to read it, you cannot just give the up-to-date copy to the other cache and not inform memory, because somebody else may want to get it from memory later on, right? That's why you need that downgrade if you want to get it from memory at some point. Well, we're going to look at that downgrade, basically. Or basically, write back on modified or share. Do you actually want to write back? Is that write back really necessary? So that write back actually causes problems, right? Why? Because you may have many processors, and one of them modifies the data, and the other one wants that data, right? And to get that data, basically, let's assume you have a lock, right? And the lock has very good locality. Locality in the sense that all of the processors want to access it somehow. One processor, let me actually write this over here such that I don't make a mess with my hands in the air. So this is processor 0, and now processor 1. Oh, thanks. How about that? Does that look a little bit better? Yeah. And processor n, let's assume that you have memory over here. Let's say this processor 1 has the block modified, and this is block A. Let's say it's writing to a lock, right? And then this processor, processor 0. And then this processor 1 wants to read it. And if it wants to read it, it could be shared data. It could be a lock. Basically, it sends a read request, and this processor sees it. It goes down to shared. This becomes shared when it receives the data. The question is, when this goes from modified to shared, does it write back the data to memory? Well, if we write back, you sent a write back. Let's say this processor 1 now got the data shared, and it wants to write to it at some point. It basically makes it modified, right? And then it invalidates this one. Now let's say another processor, after this one writes to it, this processor wants to read that data. Well, what happens is this is written back to memory, and both of them become shared. And as a result, the block gets transferred from here to here also. And if this processor later wants to write to it, it becomes modified, right? And then this gets invalidated. And then let's say another processor wants to read it later on. This gets written back. Basically, you cause a lot of unnecessary write-backs. That's the key point here, right? Even though the data is always kept in the caches and never requested from memory, you keep writing it back. And this pattern can happen, right? Especially with shared data that you're updating relatively frequently. And you may not know the whether you're going to update that shared data right away. So that write back actually is bad because it caused a lot of contention in this valuable resource, right? So how do you actually eliminate that write back? That's the idea of the MOASI protocol. Well, how do you actually eliminate that write back? If you eliminate that write back, what can you do, right? Let's assume that, I'll clean up my mess. You have the block in modified state. And you don't want to write it back to memory. You want to provide it to this processor that wants to read it. Now let's say it read it. Well, what happens now? It's modified. It's clearly dirty. If this one reads it, well, it's still dirty. Memory doesn't have the correct copy, so no one should go to memory, right? So let's say this is shared, and it's dirty. But now it's potentially dirty, right? Both of the copies are actually dirty. So what do you do? Like, how do you actually handle this block? Someone needs to write it back at some point, right? And that's the idea of the owner state. Basically, someone is designated as the owner. And this is one possibility. You can imagine many, many protocols, actually, to fix this problem. But one possibility, and I'll give you another possibility in the next slide, you add another state saying, oh, one cache is the owner. And the owner state means you actually you actually have the dirty copy, and you're responsible for writing it back. Right. And one cache owns that latest data. Memory is not updated when you go from modified to shared. But memory write back happens when all caches evict their copies. So this ownership can get actually transferred between caches. Okay. So let's reiterate. What is the problem? Basically, the key problem is shared state requires the data to be clean in MESI. Right? We don't have a state that says shared and dirty. It really requires the data to be clean. All caches that have the block have the up-to-date copy, and so does the memory in that case. That's why you need to actually, it's really semantic in the end. You really need to update the memory when you go from modified to shared. Okay? That's another way of looking at it. Right? You actually design the protocol, and that's kind of your interface. As a result, you have to update the memory when you go from modified to shared, because shared state means this. Okay? And that caused this problem. You need to write the block to memory when bus read happens when the block is in modified state. And we've discussed this. Why is this a problem? You've seen the example. Memory can be updated unnecessarily. So okay, well, I've given you one example, but let's talk about one other idea over here. Well, one other idea could be do not transition from modified to shared on a bus read, right? Invalidate the copy and supply the modified block to the requesting processor directly without updating memory. We didn't have that transition, actually, in the previous MESI. Basically, what this says is you're modified, and this one's reading it. Oh, thanks. Someone can automate this, right? Yeah. So this block is modified in this cache. And this cache wants to read it. It's not a read exclusive. It's a read. And what happens here is this cache says, oh, I want to invalidate, and I want to supply the data. Now this guy becomes a modified. That's one potential thing you can do. It may not be a good idea, especially if this one wants to read it again, right? Okay. So these ideas all have trade-offs. The second one, which is the MOASI protocol, you transition from modified to shared, but designate one cache as the owner, as we've discussed. And this cache will write the block back when it's evicted. It can actually be the one that supplies the block also. Now, shared has a separate, different meaning, right? It's before it was shared and clean. Now it can be shared and potentially dirty. Now we actually renamed what shared stands for. And this is one version of the MOASI protocol. And you can imagine other versions as well. And this is the protocol that's implemented in most systems today, most cache coherent systems. This way you reduce the writebacks. So if you think about it, from MSI to MESI, we reduce the invalidations, because exclusively you can write to a block if you have it in exclusive state. And going from MESI to MOASI, we reduce the writebacks to memory, because you don't need to write back on a modified to shared downgrade. Okay? Now you're imagining, oh, I can do better than this. And yes, you can. Now, but going from MSI to MESI, we've introduced complexity. Going from MESI to MOISI, we've introduced more complexity. And the yes you can part, you're going to introduce more complexity, probably. Basically, you can optimize the protocol with more states and maybe prediction mechanisms, right? You can say, oh, I'm going to do this transition if these conditions hold true. I'm not going to do this, and I'm going to do another transition if these other conditions hold true by prediction, predicting reuse behavior, for example, or predicting write behavior. Remember, we talked about update versus invalidate. You can predict whether or not you should invalidate depending on your reuse behavior and write behavior, write frequency. And you can do that, and this is good because it reduces the unnecessary invalidates and transfers of blocks. So you can actually optimize a lot for bandwidth as well as latency. The downside of all of this is now you make the protocol more complex. It becomes more difficult to design and verify, at least more cases to take care of, like race conditions. It's already actually, as you will see in Lab 8, it's already difficult to get this right, MESI right. And that's one of the reasons why you have Lab 8, because it gives you a state-of-the-art lab in multi-core processing. Right? That's hopefully you're looking forward to it. But you'll also see that it's going to be not easy. You'll run into race conditions. As you add more of these states, you'll run into more and more of these race conditions. Okay? And there's also this other thing, right? When do you stop? You can always optimize something, but these optimizations actually provide diminishing returns. Going from MSI to MESI provides you a lot, actually. Again, it depends on the workload, right? Like everything else, everything depends on the workload. It may buy you zero if you don't have this behavior, right? Going from, behavior we discussed. Going from MESI to MOISI buys you a little less on average. And going from MOISI to your own protocol probably is going to buy you even less. Now, that doesn't always hold true, of course, but that's usually the case. Okay. Any questions? You guys are all having fun, coherence? Which one is a simpler concept, coherence or consistency? Coherence? I agree, coherence is actually simpler to reason about because it's about a single cache block, right? Whereas consistency is really about multiple memory locations and their ordering. So I think it's more fundamentally, it's more difficult. OK, so let's revisit these methods, Snoopy bus and directory. And let's compare them. We didn't do that so far, at least fully, right? I'll call it Snoopy cache. Well, one big advantage of the Snoopy cache, as we've seen, as we've discussed, right, you eliminate the middleman, right? There is no middleman here. As a result, the miss latency is short. You just send out a request, and you have a bus transaction, and that's it. Right? Whereas with the directory, you send out the request, you go to the middleman, and middleman sends out another request, and then eventually you get it. Right? So there's a long critical path on a miss in the directory. And we'll get to that. With the Snoopy cache, global serialization is easy. Right? With coherence, what you need is serialization, as we've discussed in the last lecture, serialization to a particular cache block. It's really easy with a Snoopy bus protocol or Snoopy cache protocol. Right? Bus already provides this, right? Because it's a single point of serialization. In fact, bus provides an even stronger guarantee. Right? Everything is serialized on the bus, not only accesses to one location. And that becomes the bandwidth bottleneck as a result. It's simple, actually. You can adapt bus-based uniprocessors to this easily. Right? You can basically take a uniprocessor, another uniprocessor, put them together, connect them with a bus, and fix up the protocol. You don't need to add a directory somewhere, right? Directory doesn't exist. You need to, of course, add stuff to the cache to ensure that this happens, like metadata. But there's no directory that's added. And that's why these were the first kind of coherent machines that were implemented, bus-based multiprocessors. Well, what are the downsides? I guess I'm giving you this, so. One big downside is it relies on broadcast messages to be seen by all caches, right? In the same order. It's you broadcast. And that's one big downside of any bus-based or Snoopy protocols. What other downsides?
Doesn't scale.
That's good. Yes, it doesn't scale. basically, you can think of it as being not scalable because of this reason, right? Because it relies on broadcast messages, everything seeing every message at the same kind of instant, if you will, it doesn't scale because you have this single point of serialization, right? Well, now you can stretch your mind and think about, well, maybe I can somehow implement a virtual bus, right? One of the reasons it doesn't scale is because it's you have this physical bus, right? Can you actually somehow implement a virtual bus? Your interconnect may be not a bus, something much more sophisticated, like a network. Think of it like an internet. But can you treat it as a bus? This is where I'd like to stretch your mind, because these protocols are actually at a higher level than the physical layer, right? At the physical layer, you can have something. As long as you satisfy the higher level protocol, meaning everybody sees this location and acts as if everybody saw that request at the same time, that's a virtual bus, right? So maybe your physical implementation can be totally different. So you can have a totally ordered interconnect and ensure that everybody sees the same order somehow. That's a difficult thing, actually. It's not very easy. Okay. So what is the disadvantage? Well, let's start with the disadvantage, because the disadvantages are the exact same thing over here. Basically, turn these pluses to minuses and revert them. Basically, directory adds indirection latency, indirection to miss latency, right? Which is your critical path in handling a memory request. You first need to go to the directory to satisfy a request, and directory goes to either the memory or some other cache, right? And that's additional latency. That's fundamentally something you cannot eliminate. That's an additional message that you need to send. Well, one more thing is it requires extra storage space to track shared sets, actually. And if you do it the way we discussed, one bit per processor, that's very simple, easy to index, and people have done it actually for that reason, but it's huge. It's a lot of locations. Now you can do the calculation. You can look at a previous exam question which actually asks you to do that calculation. And I think it's in your homework also. And we get back to this, actually. How can you actually reduce the space for this? And people have tried to reduce the space. Now, Snoopy cache doesn't come for free. You need to add bits to the cache, right? But the number of bits you add scales with the number of cache blocks that you have in the system. Now you can try to make the directory that way, but it runs into a lot of complexity. Well, one good news is you can actually be approximate, right? Think about Bloom filters. It's okay to have false positives for correctness. Basically, if you send some more invalidation messages, for example, over here, it's probably okay, right? What you don't want is two processors having exclusive access to a block at the same time, right? There are some invariants, basically, you need to guarantee for this to work correctly. And there's actually a lot of formalism that you can go through to ensure that those invariants are guaranteed. But as long as those invariants are guaranteed, your protocol would be correct. Oh, somehow I have an animation error here. So because the directory is this way, it's really based on messages, your protocols and race conditions are or can be more complex, right? Because you're really dealing with more messages right now. The bus is really a nice abstraction, right? Everybody sees that message. Whereas with directory, everybody can be sending lots of different messages. For example, one thing that you need to deal with in a directory that you don't need to deal with in a physical bus-based, physical Snoopy bus is, what if two processors want to access the same location at the same time and they want to have exclusive access? What do you do? They both send their requests through different paths to the directory. Directory has a request. Well, it needs to arbitrate, right? That's the first thing. Bus already does that arbitration for you. In directory, you need to have a separate arbitration mechanism. And let's say you grant the request to one processor and don't grant the request to another processor. What do you do? The granted processor is good, but what do you do with this request that you received? Well, you can buffer it and service it later, right? That's one option. That adds complexity. Or you can say, request again, right? That's called a NAC, or negative acknowledgement. Basically, for the request that you don't satisfy, you say to that processor, I cannot satisfy your request right now, so request it again, right? So you send a NAC to that processor. But that is complexity. Now you need to deal with the NAC messages, right? And when does that processor send it back? If it requests it again, but if you don't want to give it to that for a similar reason, you knack it again, right? So you can run into a lot of fairness and starvation issues here. Whereas that single point of serialization in bus is really nice, right? And remember, the latencies could be very high with a directory-based system. Okay. But the big advantage is it doesn't require broadcast to all caches, right? This kind of protocol is nice because no need to broadcast. Directory exactly knows who has the data, assuming it's a perfect directory, and sends invalidation requests to only those caches, right? If you think about the bus, actually the energy efficiency may be lower also because all the caches access their tag stores at every request that's broadcast on the bus, right? Whereas with the directory, we just need to access the tag store for those caches that actually have the data, that the directory deems should be accessed. Okay? A lot of trade-offs. And the big advantage, of course, on top of this, I guess if I'd asked you, you would have told me that it's scalable. It is scalable, right? It's exactly as scalable as your interconnect and directory storage, which is much more scalable than your bus, hopefully. Or at least much easier to scale. Okay, any questions? If not, let's revisit the directory-based cache coherence a little bit. I'm wondering, maybe we should take a break first. Let's take a break, and let's be back at 2:30. Should get started, and maybe we'll have the hope of finishing early. Okay. Basically, we've already seen this. So directory-based cache coherence, you know it. Let's take a look at some issues over here. Basically, directory-based protocols are usually required when you're scaling past the capacity of a single bus. Right? Single bus can sustain maybe 16 processors, maybe 32 if you stretch it. And then you may go into virtual bus, but how do you enable a virtual bus? That's something you guys may want to think of, right? But people have not come up with very good ways of enabling a virtual bus-based Snoopy protocol. So a lot of systems use directory-based protocols. These protocols are distributed, actually. If you look at it, it's really a distributed system in the end. You can distribute, you can partition the directory across different nodes. But coherence still requires a single point of serialization for write serialization. Remember, you need to serialize the writes to a cache block. And serialization location can be different for every block. So one method that systems use is they stripe the locations across the nodes. So if you have 1,000 nodes, again, maybe the location cache block 0 is in this node, 1 is in this node, 2 is in this node, 3 is in this node, dot, dot, dot. And you basically do the striping. It's like cache block interleaving across the nodes, right? You can have different, very different ways of interleaving this, of course. And that could be configurable. So you can actually reason about a protocol for a single block, right? You can think of it as a server client. I'm not going to call it programming again, but it's really a server client model. You have a server, which is a directory node. And you have many clients, private caches. And private caches basically request access for the data from the server, right? And directory, and how do they request access? By sending requests, right? Directory, the server receives read and reads exclusive requests and sends invalidation requests. In this case, invalidation is explicit, right? We have explicit invalidation requests and explicit acknowledgement requests. This is another difference between Snoopy buses. In Snoopy buses, you kind of, when you broadcast a read exclusive, you implicitly invalidate, right? Does that make sense? I guess except if you have a MESI protocol. In an MSI protocol, you need to explicitly invalidate. Although you don't explicitly invalidate again, but you send a read exclusive request, right? Yeah. So there are no explicit invalidation messages in the Snoopy protocol. Okay. Let's take a look at the data structure. So this is something that we discussed briefly. Data structures are really required to support invalidation and cache block requests, right? You need to know where a cache block, whether or not a memory block is cached in some place. And this is one example of this, right? And this is a very abstract example. This is what you really need to know, right, in the end. For a cache block, what state is it in, and which caches is it in. So for example, cache block 4, it's not in any cache. Implicitly, you can go back and say that maybe you can somehow eliminate this right from the directory. And that's the idea that you had. But once you eliminate it, the directory becomes harder to manage also. So there are many different kinds of data structures you can have. Key operation to support is kind of a set inclusion test, right? Who has this block, basically? And false positives, being conservative, is OK in the sense that as long as you know which caches may contain a copy of the block, you're fine. You send spurious invalidations, perhaps. Maybe the directory, you can simplify the directory by saying, oh, these caches may contain the block. Right? And then the directory sends requests or invalidation requests to all of those caches when someone else wants the block to as read exclusive. As a result, some caches may receive an invalidation request, even though they may not have the block. They just ignore that invalidation request in that case, right? Okay. But in this case, of course, false positive rate determines your performance. How many extra invalidation requests do you send? Right? Actually, you can, in the worst case, you can invalidate all of the caches, right? So you're kind of going back to a Snoopy protocol in that case. When you receive a message saying read exclusive, you can invalidate all of the caches through the directory. Then you may not need to actually keep any of this information. But that sounds like a bad idea, right? You're always sending invalidation requests. So most accurate and expensive is really the full bit vector, or actually most accurate, expensive, and also simple, I should say, because you can index into it really quickly. So if you have a full bit vector, it's really most accurate. But you can also have compressed representations. And I'm not going to go through this in detail. But you can also have linked lists, for example, instead of having bit vectors. Because a bit vector may be less scalable also, right? If you have a million processors, a million nodes, you need a million bits. But only one, on average, you may find out that only one processor caches a block, right? You're really storing a million bits in the bit vector, whereas you could actually store just the ID of that node that has the block. But now your data structure is a little bit different. And you can actually have other representations. They're all possible, but these increase the complexity of lookup of the structure. Let's look at the basic operations a little bit. The basic operations actually follow the semantics of a Snoop-based system. That's why the protocols are actually similar, right? You can actually implement a VI protocol, MSI protocol, MESI protocol, MOESI protocol on the Snoopy bus or the directory. Exactly the same protocol. Protocol is basically a state machine. That's it. Right? Where you have those states, whether it's in the cache, and how you update those states, that is determined by actually the underlying mechanism, Snoopy bus or directory based. And you can have combinations of these two, by the way. Right? You can have partially Snoopy bus. If you have a hierarchical system, for example, part of it has a Snoopy bus. And when you actually want to scale up, you can have directory. And you can keep a kind of a small directory inside that part. But we're not going to go into that. If you want to scale the system, you may want to have heterogeneity. OK. And we've actually talked about this earlier, right? So I'm not going to talk about this. But basically, you have a lot of flexibility here. You can forward to the request to memory if needed. And you can actually communicate between processors saying that, oh, processor X, you should send this data, this block, to processor Y. So you can actually have a lot of messages. And the design is flexible. Exact forwarding paths depend on the implementation. Can you do cache-to-cache transfer, for example? So let's take a look at a couple of examples just to show you how flexible this is. Let's say processor 0 wants to read an address. It basically sends a read request to the directory or home node. It's also called home node. Basically, you have the block. Let's say the block is A. You should somehow know where to send the message to. That's the first step, right? If the directory is distributed across nodes, this block has a home node somewhere, which means that you should find that. There needs to be a predictable mapping between the address and the home node. You send a read request to the home node. And the home node basically can send the data as exclusive or as shared, right? Even though you may send a read request, you may get the data exclusive, right? If the directory deems that, oh, you should get it exclusive, right? OK? And this could be another way, right? If home nodes, if the directory determines that that cache block is actually in processor 1's cache, it can say processor 1, why don't you send the data to processor 0, right? Make sense? But I'm missing some messages perhaps here, right? Somehow you may actually want an acknowledgement saying that processor 1 delivered and processor 0 received it, right? Especially in a large scale system. Okay, so let's take a look at another example. This is processor 0. It wants to read some data. This is so it wants to actually write to a piece of data. It requests that data with a read exclusive request from the home node. And home node determines that actually somebody else has the data. And it basically sends an invalidation request to that owner. And the owner basically gives the data back to the home node. This is also called a revision. And at the same time, the owner may do this, right? So it can actually overlap latencies. And this may make sense if this processor is somehow much closer to this one, right? Again, this is very similar to what we've discussed before. If you have multiple paths in your interconnect, especially, you can do all these optimizations. And again, this is really complicating. Well, let's actually have these processor 0, processor 1, and then the directory far away. This one wants a read exclusive request. That's the first thing that's sent. And the directory figures out that processor 1 actually has the data. And it sends an invalidation request plus a message, or maybe embedded in the same message, saying send to processor 0, right? And this one, and then as well as me, maybe, right? That could be another thing. But maybe you don't want that, OK? So basically, if this connection is much shorter than this connection, you can actually have a much better, much lower latencies in this transfer. That's clear, hopefully. Again, I mean, ignoring the messages for acknowledgement over here, right? Again, you need to acknowledge it such that the directory knows. Exactly, because there you can imagine lots of race conditions here, right? While this is happening, somebody else may request it, right? Again, what does the directory do? One thing the directory can do is, until it gets an acknowledgement from this previous request, it doesn't grant the block to anyone. But then you need the acknowledgement, right? That's the problem. That's exactly why you need the acknowledgement, because somebody else may request the block, then you may get to an inconsistent state if you actually didn't get the acknowledgement. OK, let's take a look at this is what I discussed earlier, contention resolution. There's something else that the directory needs to do. Let's say two nodes want the data as read exclusive. The directory decides, oh, I'm going to supply it to this guy, and I'm going to knack the other one. And what happens later? You have one unhappy processor, right? Well, unhappy processor requested again, right? But then you have a design choice here. Actually, you have multiple issues over here, right? First of all, you knack the request. Is that the right thing to do? Maybe you buffer the request, right? And the unhappy processor later causes an invalidation here. And then this is what may happen, right? And the processor becomes happy. But contention, yes?
Could you run to a problem where another processor requests again before it, and then you have to decide whether to service the unhappy processor or the new processor?
Yeah, exactly. You run into fairness issues, basically. You could run into that problem. Basically, contention resolution introduces other races also. And you can escape the race conditions by knacking the requests to entries, to directory entries that are kind of busy, right? Basically, these are the directory entries that they're waiting for an acknowledgement or some invalidation or something, right? You can actually decide whether a directory entry actually has a pending transaction on it at this point. And you can say, anybody else who wants to access this directory entry at this point, I'm going to knack them, right? That's one simple protocol. And hopefully that doesn't run into race conditions, because you service one transaction for that particular cache block, and then move on to the next transaction, right? That's one way of doing it. And the original requester retries, but then somebody else may get in and actually get the block in this case. How do you ensure fairness, right? Or you can queue the requests and grant them in sequence, right? This actually may be more fair. maybe. Or you can have a combination, right? But the problem with the queuing of requests is you need enough buffering space, right? What is that buffering space? Do you have enough? If you run out of buffer space, maybe you start nacking requests, right? And this leads to fairness issues. Which requester should be preferred in a conflict? And do you even know that conflict, right? With the bus, you eliminate a lot of this. And a lot of things matter in this case, right? Interconnect delivery order, right? For example, you can run into starvation issues because some processor that's very close to the directory may be requesting that block a lot, and some processor really far away from the directory, naturally it takes a much longer time to request that block, right? If it keeps getting nacked, maybe it'll never get that block, right? Okay, there's also ping-ponging, as we've discussed. Ping-ponging was actually the movement of the shared data or locks between the caches, right? But you can actually solve this this is really a higher level issue, right? Maybe you eliminate this with better structure design. We're not going to go into that right now. Let's look at the scaling of directory, right? This is something that we briefly touched upon again. I'll ask you some questions. How large is the directory? I guess I've given you the answer. It turns out it's pretty large, right? Especially if you want to have a huge system. You can do the calculation in your homework question. It basically scales with the size of your memory as well as the size of your multiprocessor, how many nodes you have. Something that we didn't discuss that much, how do you reduce the access latency to this directory? You can distribute it such that you don't have it in a centralized place, and by distributing it, or partitioning and distributing it, that way you can hopefully have reasonable access because now you have more bandwidth to the directory as well instead of having it in a single place. That reduces access latency. But is that enough? Again, whenever you're reading a block, you need to go all the way to the directory node, right? That could be a lot, especially in a large-scale multiprocessor. What can you do? Anybody? How do you reduce latency, long latencies? We've seen this many, many times in this course. Yeah? Don't be scared. You have long latency memory. What do you add? Cache, exactly. You cache the directory, right? And existing systems cache the directory. Now, it's interesting, right? You cache the directory. Directory was supposed to actually provide coherence in caches. So now how do you handle the coherence in the directory, right? Well, this is like the page table, right, that we've seen. You have the page tables in virtual memory. So think about it a little bit. This is something that can boggle your mind, but it's doable. Well, this is another question. How do you scale the system to thousands of nodes, right? And all of these matter in this case, right? So one question is, can we get the best of snooping and directory protocols? So something for you to think about. But maybe you can have a hierarchical design. Partially you have Snoopy protocols, and partially you have directory protocols, right? Maybe within, and usually hierarchical designs are the most scalable designs. And I'll give you another idea soon. But if you want to scale them, so this answers this question. By kind of trying to have both protocols in the system. Maybe you can say, oh, thanks. I keep doing that today, huh? Maybe you can actually have a bus-based protocol in this part, another bus-based protocol in this part, Snoopy protocol, another here, another here, right? But then have a directory in between these, right? And maybe when you get out of this, you actually consult the directory somehow. This way, if the block is shared only between these, this portion of the multiprocessor, you never send messages outside, right? Of course, you need to have some metadata to actually know that the block is actually within this domain, if you will. And then you can actually scale with directory. Well, one other option is actually have another bus over here, right? You could potentially do that also. So this is called hierarchical buses, basically. And this is one way of scaling with bus-based systems. And if you have good design, perhaps you can do that. But this doesn't have to be buses. This can be any kind of interconnect between these. And you can actually have directory. Right? So you can imagine how to scale the systems to large number of nodes. So this is one way of actually combining multiple solutions. I'll very briefly, and this is actually, this gives you heterogeneity, right? Basically, you have some parts of the system using Snoopy protocols, some other parts of the system using directory-based protocols. This is one use of heterogeneity to scale the system. There's another use of heterogeneity, which I like. I'll use Milo Martin from University of Pennsylvania, his slides, to very briefly give you the idea. Even if you don't have this huge scalable system, can we still get the best of Snoopy and directory protocols? Basically, I like this chart because you kind of desire three things, right? If you want to scale the system. You want low latency when you have cache-to-cache misses. Right? You want no bus-like interconnect. And you want to be bandwidth efficient. Right? Let's take a look at like some of the trends. If you have workloads, it turns out you actually want very low latency. You want to directly get the data from the cache. Whereas with directory, you cannot do that, right? You really need to go through directory. It adds that extra hop. Even if you cache the directory, you still need to go to that directory cache. Right? So I'm going to skip a lot of these. But basically, the basic idea is this. Directory protocol, you got to go to the directory somehow. Whereas with bus-based systems, you eliminate that step. So you don't want that. So workload trends kind of want snooping protocols, right? The reason is you want low latency in many workloads. Now, there are workloads where you don't care about latency, but that's not the hard problem, if you will. The hard problem is really where you really care about latency. And a lot of workloads, actually, you care about latency, transaction latency, for example. So workload trends are pulling you over here, right? And for snooping protocols, you get a direct request and response. The downside is it requires a virtual bus. And the downside is it's not bandwidth efficient, right? Basically, it requires broadcast. Technology trends, on the other hand, kind of push you against that bus, right? Because if you have this bus, that's hard to build. At least it's hard to build at high frequency. Whereas if you build point-to-point links, that's much, you can make it much faster, right? Now, point-to-point links, you may have a lot of links, but it's much faster. And we'll talk about interconnects in a later lecture. So technology trends kind of are pushing you away from this bus, right? Whereas they're pulling you towards something like this. And if you don't know what the something like this is basically what we will talk about in the interconnect lecture. But this is basically a multi-stage network. That's how you connect processors and memories, or processors and processors. And you can think of these as routers, right? OK, I'll skip this. Basically, this. So this is, in the past, things are, so this is more scalable than this one, clearly. And you'll see that in the interconnect lecture. But this may be even more scalable, right? Because now you're actually kind of, you don't need to go through this network, but you kind of directly connect multiprocessors together. So your desire, however, is you want this low latency interconnect, right? And you want to avoid this virtual bus ordering. And this is enabled by directory protocols. So in a sense, the technology is pulling you towards this no bus-like interconnect or directory-like protocols, if you will. But you don't get low latency if you have directory-like protocols, right? You get no bus-like interconnect, which is good. And hopefully, it's more bandwidth efficient because you don't have broadcast, right? You can imagine a broadcast. You can imagine doing broadcast on any kind of network, right? You can imagine doing broadcast on the internet, for example, right? Think about how terrible it would be to do broadcast on the entire internet. Bad idea. But directory-based protocols are bandwidth efficient because you send invalidations, for example, only to the directory, only to the nodes that have the data. So ideally, a protocol that you design in cache coherence, you want all three attributes, right? You want low latency on a miss. You want no scalability bottleneck, and you want no bandwidth bottleneck. Right? How do you get both of them? Well, I'll give you his idea very briefly, but this is one idea. And it's not implemented yet, but I like the idea, at least the spirit of it. But it doesn't solve this particular part of the problem. solves kind of this nicely, I think. So basically, remember I talked about invariants earlier? When you have invalidation-based coherent, there is one invariant. You can have many readers to a block. Coherence is all about a single block, right? You can have many readers to that block or a single writer. Right? As long as you keep that invariant, you can maybe design a protocol that is low latency as well as hopefully it doesn't require a bus-like interconnect. And the idea over here is, and you can develop your own idea maybe, you can enforce this invariant directly using tokens, right? You can have tokens, a fixed number of tokens per block. And if a block wants to, if a processor wants to read that block, it just needs to have one token. If it wants to write to that block, it needs to gather all the tokens and keep it while it's writing to that block. And this kind of guarantees the invariant, right? You can have many readers, but when you want to write to it, gather the tokens such that no one actually can read it. No one can have a token. And this guarantees safety in this case. Basically, you can enforce this global invariant with only local rules. Local rules meaning this processor wants to write that block, basically it sends requests, asks for the tokens. And tokens eventually arrive. You don't need a bus for this, right? Tokens somehow come as long as the messages get to the processors that have the tokens. And you keep the tokens, you keep all the tokens until you're done with that block. And then when someone else wants it, when you're done with your write, you can actually give your tokens to others, right? So this is nice because it's kind of decoupling the protocol nicely by specifying the invariants, right? Does that make sense? Now we can optimize for performance somehow, right? How do you actually deliver these tokens? It's kind of decoupling the correctness of the protocol, right? Correctness is really built upon by this invariant. As long as you satisfy this invariant, and hopefully you can prove that, maybe. Well, you should prove that if you're designing this protocol. Your design will be correct. Underneath, you can actually speculatively access tokens, for example, right? You can speculatively request access to the tokens because you may know that you're going to write to it at some point, write to that cache block. Okay. Oh, well. I think we're done with coherence at this point. Any questions? Yes. This one.
Yeah, what's different from the smoking base? Because like smoking base, you invalidate everyone else, right? So if you think about the invalidation, like the valid bit as a token, it's almost like you're just gathering all the tokens.
Except you don't have explicit tokens.
Well, if your cache is the only one that's valid when you write to it, that's kind of like a token you have.
That's right. But you need to have some interconnect underneath, right?
Yeah.
Which guarantees that. So in a sense, what this is doing is by explicitly introducing this notion of tokens, you don't rely on the underlying interconnect to guarantee that when you have the valid bit set, nobody else has it. Right? That's the difference. Any questions? Thoughts? You can design your own protocol. Should we stop here or should we move on to asymmetry? You have a choice now. We're going to change gears, so. Maybe we should stop here. But we can take questions on coherence if you want. It seems like a good place.
Is the new topic more about cache?
Asymmetry, oh, he's interested, look. It's not about caching, it's about asymmetry. Basically, we're going to talk about asymmetry in a later lecture. Now I have the question, should I start it? I don't think I'll start it. I'll let you think about it. You can look at last year's lecture and find it over there. But you might as well come to class next time. But we're done with coherence right now. The rest, we're going to cover interconnects. Now, hopefully, you've seen that interconnects are actually a really important part of designing a scalable system, right? We're going to cover different choices for that. And I haven't decided which order I'm going to cover this in. There is no coherence issue, so I can cover them in any order. Because asymmetry is also interesting because we're going to make use of coherence to actually accelerate critical sections, for example, accelerate bottleneck portions of the programs. Whereas interconnects, we'll talk about how to actually do that. So if there are no questions, we can stop here. Oh, yeah. So you need the interconnect to eventually satisfy the messages, right? The interconnect should not you don't need that information, right? You never need to know which processor is using which token, right? So this processor doesn't need to know which other processor has tokens. As long as this processor, when it wants to write, it can get all the tokens within some time. As long as the interconnect can guarantee that, you're fine, right? And when it wants to read, it needs to get the tokens also. So interconnect basically needs to be able to satisfy the read and write requests for the tokens. Does that make sense? So in a sense, in this case, you don't need any state. So you don't need any state like directory. You need more state to actually track the tokens, clearly. But you can have an interconnect that's very scalable without having the disadvantages of the directory. And hopefully you still have the latency advantages, right? You can do cache-to-cache transfers in this case, right? When you send, for example, a read request, a processor that has the block just sends it to you. Right? Okay? If you guys don't want to go. It's Friday, you can start your lab. Yeah, one more question. So you need one token to read.
One block is reading. Then the other blocks just stay there, right? They don't. What happens to their tokens?
So this is per block. So for each block, you have n tokens, let's say. And you need to get one token to be able to read it. And you keep that token, right, while you're reading it.
And then you give it back
if you're done reading, right? Or if someone requests to write it. Right?
So if someone else is simultaneously reading to it, then someone else can also read to it because it can take a token.
Exactly, because there are enough tokens, right? That's the hope.
And that token width depends on like how many buses or how much bandwidth you have to supply it to.
That's right, yeah. I mean, how many tokens you have basically depends on how many concurrent readers you want to have, right? You can have as many tokens as the number of processors in the system.
Yeah.
But then you need to keep track of the number, obviously, right? A single writer. Yes, that's right. That's right. That concept applied to coherence. I mean, this is one way of actually designing distributed algorithms also, right? Actually, if you take a distributed systems class at some point, you may design token-based algorithms. Because this is really enabling the distribution of work. Yeah?
Before we learn about the range of tokens, it's relying on the implementation of the interconnect.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Exactly. Yeah, that's right. It's different. Yeah, this is that's exactly the point. The whole point is to separate the abstraction, basically separate the implementation from the protocol itself, the high-level protocol, by specifying an invariant. That's why I like this. That's why I wanted to talk about it. Even though it's not implemented in processors, this is a good way of thinking about systems. You have some invariants that you want to satisfy, and there are many ways of satisfying that invariant. And we've seen multiple ways, right? The Snoopy protocol satisfied that with a Snoopy bus. The directory-based protocol satisfied with the directory. But actually, you can do it in many ways, right? As long as you satisfy this particular invariant. OK. I guess one burning question, yes?
So when you have coherence implemented, does that give you consistency? Since only you can only have one processor writing at a time to a given
What do you think? It still doesn't say anything about the order.
No.
That's why that's a harder problem, right? Exactly, you answered it. No.
It does if the data is on the same block.
Exactly, yes. Because consistency is about ordering of different blocks. Yeah. That's why it's a harder problem. OK, I guess we're done now then.